been talking to you about could you not pray 1 hour. And it's very timely because we need to spend time with God in prayer. If you want to hear God's voice, you're not going to hear God's voice just on happenstance. You've got to spend time in His Word. You've got to meditate in His Word. You've got to open His Word. You read and you think about what you're reading and you pray about what you're reading. If you want to begin to discern His voice, it takes time. Time to wait. Sometimes we've got so much noise going on in our head, we don't know it's God. But when you get up, especially early in the morning, when you get up and it's the freshness of the day, and you can spend time, many times I do it at night, but I had so much junk in my mind from the day, it took me a while to get my head clear so I could hear from God. So much noise. When you wake up in the morning, sometimes early in the morning, it's just such a freshness when you can sit before God and meditate on the Word of God and listen to His voice. Give us this day our daily bread. We didn't get there yet, but He'll give you your daily bread. He'll give you the Word for the day. Listen, I thank God for you like the believers that sent out text the Word of the day, but God wants to give you the Word of the day directly from Him. If you'll seek Him and go get your manna every day, sometimes we work trying to work out problems in our own strength. And God's saying, if you just come before me, child, and sit before me, I'd give you a word, and you'd have a word before the problem came. That's what I say to the Lord. You'd have a word before the problem came. You'd have a scripture before you got in the situation. You'd already know what to do. Because God is way ahead. Amen? Listen, God, when you talk about prayer, He's way ahead of the devil's just back. They don't know what's going on. God's way ahead. If we'll seek His face, He'll give us a word. Now, this prayer was a pattern of prayer that Jesus taught His disciples. Jesus, the Son of God, God in the flesh, had to pray much. He spent much time in prayer. He went from one place of prayer to another place. When He chose His 12 disciples, He spent the whole night in prayer. When's the last time He spent the whole night in prayer? I know you guys, you can see some of it. The whole night in prayer about a decision or a situation. When you wait on God and you seek God, you got to wait on God. It may not come in a day. It may not come the next day. You may have to fast and pray for a while before you get that answer. And why does God wait? I don't always know, but I'm here to tell you, if you wait on God, you seek Him with all your heart, you're going to find Him. You're going to find Him. Some answers have come quickly, and some took some time, but they always came. So we're on the part of verse 10, Thy kingdom come. And we're going to talk about the coming kingdom of God. Number one, the kingdom of God within us is the Holy Spirit. I can't show you the Holy Spirit, but I can show you a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. In other words, just as the wind blows on a tree, I can't show you the wind, but you see the tree moving in the wind. So it is with the kingdom of God. The Holy Spirit comes upon an individual. You become another woman and another man. But there's a coming kingdom that is soon to come to a theater near you. Jesus is coming back. And there are events in the world that are taking place right now. It will affect you. We're not going to be isolated here in America from what's coming. I mean to tell you. And many in the church that aren't serious about God are going to be shaken right out like fruit from a tree that they're not tightly holding on. Things are coming. And it's coming to us. It's coming to America. God's been speaking to me and showing me. Now, like a woman with birth pains, the closer the child gets, the more pain. Now, ladies, I see my wife when she was having our children, and it was, you know, I tried to talk to her, and she was like, ow, fuck it. I mean, it was just like that. And I obeyed quickly. Yes, ma'am. Don't say a word. Like the pain she was going through. And it happened really quick, I remember. It happened quick. Things are happening, and it's closer to the coming of the Lord. The birth pains will be more rapid. There will be earthquakes. There will be changes in the weather pattern. It already is. It already is earthquakes, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Some of the things that have happened. That's not actually the word that I have to give you. Now, hopefully, I'll get to it. I've got 15 minutes. I have to preach fast. My goodness. So, Matthew 24, let me go back. Amen. Huh? Oh, we didn't pray for the present. Let's pray really quick. I'll do it right now. Father, in Jesus' name, we bless Donald Trump. I make every curse spoken over him. Every negative thing. Forgive Johnny Depp for what he said, Lord God. And Father, we bless President Trump. Compass him about with men and women of faith. We pray for the cabinet, the leaders of this land. Give them wisdom. Give them knowledge and protect them and keep them, Lord God. Extend the grace of God on America, God. We pray. Lord, you said to pray, and this church prays for the president, prays for the leaders of this land. We obey your word. I bind every demon, devil of hell, every witch that has cursed the president. We just pray a blessing, God, to go forth. We pray those same witches that curse the president will get saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and become prayer warriors, God. We call them out of darkness into the marvelous light of God, that they get saved and filled with your spirit and become intercessors. In Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, fix it. That's what we're going to say. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. Got a true article in prison today. They said, witches are cursing the president on a full moon or whatever. they do that. They're really coming against them. So I've been praying for that salvation. We'll fix the devil. We'll get you back to his soul. Right out of his orphan eyes. Glory to God. Matthew 24:3. While he was seated on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately and said, "Tell us, when will this take place?" He's talking about his coming. "And what will be the sign of your coming and the completion of the age?" So when is this going to happen? What's the sign? Who do we look for? And what's the consummation of the age? Matthew 24. The first thing Jesus said is, "Be careful that no one misleads you, deceiving you, and leading you into error." Guys, I got to tell you this, and I have to tell you this. I used to be able to preach end times. I read all the books. I don't want to mention the names. I read more books than you can count. I loved end times, and I studied. A good friend of mine, actually some of his members are here today, Pastor Robert Joseph Schubert, asked me a question at the time. He wasn't pastor, he was I. The question was, "What is the last trump?" He said, "Brother Joe, what is the last trump?" I said, "Well, last means last." And it was kind of a disingenuous answer, but I had been taught about the end times. So I began to pray, and I said, "God, I'm going to talk all this about the end times, but I need to know what your word says. But not what man says, but what do you say about end times?" And I began to read the Bible, and as I began to read the Bible, revelation began to come, and it was going counter what everybody else was saying. And I said, "God, this is going counter what everybody else is saying." And as God began to reveal more and more to me, whenever I didn't say it, God said, "You know what I've showed you." And I said, "God, if ever I'm going to place a pastor or a minister, I will tell your people what you showed me. What you showed me in the 90s. I just heard a minister recently, 2006, they had a big conference, prophetic conference, good news conference is what it was. And he said, you know, we're talking about the end times, and the Lord appeared to him, and the Lord said, these are the beginning of sorrows. He said, "God, this is not good news. This is a good news conference, and this is not good news." He said, "I don't care what you think about that." He said, "All you guys got it wrong." He said, "All these people think one thing's going to happen at the end times." He said, "You got it wrong." And what's amazing is he's saying what I'm saying. Jesus did not appear to me. He just granted me revelation by his Spirit through the Word of God. I was handed a book by a popular end times author about the sequence of end times events by Associate Pastor Hall, by Irvin Baxter, and I read it, I said, "Wait a minute, he's saying what I'm saying. I didn't even read his books, because I read the book." Yeah. The book. So some have said, it doesn't matter what you believe about the end times, it'll all pan out. It does matter. Because things are coming on the earth, you're going to see a lot of things. And there's going to be a lot of bewildered Christians wondering, "I should have been out of here. I should have never seen any of this trouble. What is going on in my life? We should have been raptured by now. Yeah, I should have been raptured by 2000, but I'm still here." Right? We're going to see some stuff. And that's why God's going to pour out the glory of God on the church. Because listen, things are coming to America. So the first thing he said, be careful that no one misleads you, deceiving you, and leading you into error. There's a lot of people. Have some crazy doctrines. A lot of people lead you in error. Listen, I challenge you when I'm preaching. I put it on the screen. It's straight out of the Word. I heard one brother said, he went to one place and the man was preaching. He said, "Oh, you don't have to look in the Bible. You should know. You got to study and be like the Bereans and find out if what I'm saying is in the Word of God. Do your diligence to study to show yourself approved unto God." It's got to be in the Word. The Word of God trumps everything. Wow. You become a disciple, a disciplined follower of Jesus. So no one will lead you into an error. A little poison or a good steak will kill some people. Sometimes a little bad doctrine will mess you up. Yeah. Little bad will mess you up. One man was a great soul winner. He got some bad doctrine and he quit being a soul winner. He got messed up. Just a little thing, a little love, and leaven's a whole lump. So you got to get the pure, unadulterated Word of God. And I'm here to tell you, again, there are translations that you're missing things. The NIV, I call it the Nearly Inspired Version. There's verses missing. There is. A lot of modern translations are missing things. I use the King James and the Amplified because it's supposed to be the original. So how do you know that? Because I started reading the NIV and I said, "Wait, where's man should I live by bread alone, but every word proceeded out of the mouth of God. Where's that part? Where's that? Wasn't in that.
Come on.
Wasn't in that." Then I found out a lot was changed. Ooh. See, the enemy wants to corrupt the seed so he can get to you. You gotta have the pure Word of God. Hallelujah. The Bible says this. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Doctrine. That's teaching the Word of God. Pure Word of God. Unadulterated. Oh, there's a lot of people teaching a lot of things today. But we've got to get back to the book. If it doesn't line up with the book, you've got to throw it out. But some of us don't know the book because we don't read it. Those who cannot read are in the same position of those who don't read. You don't know. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them. For in doing this, you will save thyself and them that hear thee. I heard a story of a man, he saw hell, and he saw the preacher stand up before all the people he lied to in hell with him. And they go and preach, preacher, and they were tormenting him because he lied to them. I'm not going to lie to you. If you're in sin, I'm going to call it out. I'm not going to embarrass you. I want to preach the word of God. So you repent, get right with God, and you're going to be in heaven. Glory to God. This is going to say that. Well, I had to offend the tithe, but you offend God. I didn't get in this for money. Money had nothing to do with it. Love for God had everything to do with it. Love for his people had everything to do with it.
Amen.
No other reason, period. Wanted a place to pray. I said, God, I want to build a house for you so we can pray, seek your face, and worship you. He said the next thing he said about Aaron, for many will come in the strength of my name, appropriating the name which belongs to me, saying, I am the Christ, the Messiah, and they will lead many astray. There are many people walking around with a Messiah complex. We've seen them. The Jim Joneses and the crazy people that have come and led people astray into their death. Wherever you find somebody like this, there will be sexual immorality. Bad doctrine breeds sexual immorality. They'll be sleeping with the women. There's always sexual immorality where there's error. Error. Or some prophet or prophetess or whatever it may be, trying to control and manipulate people through the gift. Oh yeah. Error. I don't listen. I thank God for every prophet here. But we follow the Spirit of God. See, guys, I'm not trying to hook you up with me. I'm trying to hook you up with him. Because when you get hooked up with him, you'll hear him. You have a direct relationship. Sometimes people want, well, I'll go to this one to hear from God. No, no, no. In the New Testament, you don't go to the seer. You don't go to the prophet. The seer and the prophet will confirm what you got. You go to God in prayer, and you listen to the Spirit of God. God wants a relationship directly with you.
Hallelujah.
You got to have a hook up with him. When many ministers fell, people fell away. Well, who are you following anyway? The Bible says, follow me as I follow Christ. But ultimately, we follow Christ. You get your eyes on him. Man will fail, but God will never fail you. We've got to be hooked up directly with him. Intimacy with him, so you know him. So many have fallen and followed many. He said this, you'll hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not frightened or troubled. For this must take place, but the end is not yet. World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam. Satan rattling right now. World War III is going to happen. According to the book of Revelation, 2 billion people, one-third of mankind, will die in this war. Peter said the elements will melt with fervent heat. That's atoms. It looks like nuclear from when you read in the Bible. It's going to happen. When is it going to happen? I don't know. But it's happening in these end times. Some have said they believe World War III has already begun with the advent of terrorism around the world. It's not normal to have terrorism around the world because America and many places did not repent like they should. The enemy has risen up.
Come on now.
The enemy has risen up. There's four horsemen of the apocalypse. There's a white horse with no arrows, which represents the papacy. There's a red horse, which is communism, red China, red Russia. A black horse, which is capitalism. But there's one horse, which is called the pale horse. Pale is translated wrong. It should be translated, it's chloros, it's green. Green horse, the color of Islamic terrorism is green. Islamic terrorism is riding through the earth today. It's in your Bible and it's in the news. And many of the churches think they think they don't have to pray. You read Revelation, they cut people's heads off. For the testimony. It's in the book of Revelation. I watched the video of a house. There was an Egyptian man chopping people's heads off. There were heads all against the wall and bodies hanging from the ceiling without heads cut at the shoulder because they wouldn't accept the Muslim faith because they died for what they believe. Christian brothers and sisters being raped and beheaded right now in the world. And many in America, we sit in our laurels. It can't happen to us because God loves us more. We're in America. Thank God for America. For this constitution that was put by our forefathers, that's where we have the freedoms. But too often we go to sleep and we'll let our freedoms slip away. It's coming. Things are coming to America. And the church is not ready. The military, we are trained. When the bombs explode, the bullets fly, we know what to do. You respond with muscle memory. But many in the church are not ready and will be bewildered because their pastors didn't tell them. I told the pastor I was coming to America. I told you that an earthquake is going to hit the center of this nation. I told him these things, and he looked at me, he had no idea. No idea. I'm telling you, when I hear from God, I'm going to tell you. You may get mad at me. You may not like it, but I'm worried about what But too many speak negative things over the president. And I'm amazed at these entertainers. Talking about Madonna, burn the White House down. How dare she say such things? And so many Christians don't even recognize their duty in praying for the president and praying for the leaders of this land. We as a church are going to do it. Because we will stand before God and say, why didn't you pray for the leaders? Why didn't you pray? Yes, you will. You'll give account to God. And don't say, Pastor Joe never told you, because I told you. I told you. There's famine. Famine. So often we see in Africa the famine that's there. But I got a word for you from Heidi Baker. You know, Heidi Baker is a Mozambique. She's an apostle to Mozambique. And she ministers to the starving children. And she came to America and got a word from God of what she saw, a vision for America. And I want you to see it in a second. I'm going to show you in a second, right after this. Now this is the book of Acts. Somebody say, I want to go to the book of Acts, right? Book of Acts, watch this. And one of them, named Agabus, he's a prophet, stood up and prophesied through the Holy Spirit that a great and severe famine would come upon the whole world. That was in the book of Acts. Let's go back to the book of Acts. Well, guess what? There you go. And it occurred during the reign of Claudius. So the disciples resolved to send relief, each according to an individual ability in proportion as he prospered, to the brethren who lived in Judea. So should you have some preparation? Yes, you should. Yes, you should. There's stuff coming, and you need to be ready for it. I don't want you to say that Pastor John told me this. I'm telling you. Do what you got to do. Because we're going to experience some things here in America. I'm 12 o'clock, I'm going to finish. I'm going to speak two more slides, and that's it. And I'll be able to show you what God showed me. Some composites of the Word of God and what's coming again to America. You need to hear it. Hear it. Pestilence, global pestilence from AIDS to Zika. Another prophet just prophesied because of what America has done to Israel. You know what America's done, by the way? December 16, 2016, at the UN, they put America, as Obama was leading, put a resolution in to divide Israel, to divide Jerusalem. And why that's so important is we betrayed them because we did not veto the vote. We propagated it, did not veto it. And because of that, when they prophesied some of the things that have come in American pestilence, there's AIDS, disease, and a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff. We could be like John G. Link, touches your body and dies through the power of the Holy Ghost. We don't have to be afraid under the blood of the Lamb. How will we know evil shall befall us? Psalm 91. But we've got to be walking in the Spirit and the things of God. We're going to see these things in the news. Here's another one. Earthquakes. Earthquakes. We forget 2004. A quarter of a million almost people died in Indonesia from an earthquake. Japan, the Japan earthquake that happened. 15, almost 60,000 people died. There's an earthquake in Chile. It rocked the earth on its axis. It's changed weather patterns. The jet stream moving. There's so many things happening. The ring of fire is waking up. And just this week, you can look, June 21st, Yellowstone, 464 small earthquakes. They're looking at Yellowstone right now. The volcanic area of Yellowstone, the ring of fire is waking up. There's going to be things that are going to happen on our soil here and around the world. We are in the end times. We're there. There was a man named John Paul Jackson, a great prophet of God, went home to be with the Lord. He said he had an 11th hour ministry, and he's gone now. He's gone. Now, back in 2007, he had a video called The Perfect Storm, which we watched, of things that were coming and coming to pass. He's gone. So if he had an 11-hour ministry, I must have 11:59, 30 seconds. I don't know what it is, but my goodness, we're still here. We're still here. Earthquakes. These are the beginning of sorrows, the child pains. And I won't be able to get into it. Then he said this. Now look. Then they will hand you over to suffer affliction and tribulation. You know what tribulation means? Persecution. That's what it means. As a matter of fact, you read the book of Revelation. It says, Satan hath come down to you having great wrath. And then most people say, oh, we're not here for the tribulation. No, tribulation means persecution. It's called the great persecution. That's what's coming from the whole earth. It's coming on the whole earth. Because God's going to refine his sons through fire. You know what refining fire does, right? I shared this with somebody this week. You take a big pot, and you have gold, and you put it in there, but you have so much other impurities in it, so it takes heat to get the impurities out. And what happens is the impurities rise to the top, and then the refiner takes a ladle, and he scoops it in, and he takes out the dross and throws it away, and he keeps this process, and he keeps the heat up until he can look into the gold and see his reflection. God wants to look into our life and see his reflection. So some of us, you mentioned the fiery trial. We will go through fiery trials. Now, next week I got to share with you about the anointing and things he showed me about again what's coming. But I want to say that the fiery trials are going to purify the sons of Levi, the priests of God. We're going through, and he's coming back to a church without spot or wrinkle. How do you get wrinkles out of your clothes? Anyone guess? Yeah, I know that might be the one to dry look the best, but God's going to get wrinkles out of the church, and it's going to be through heat. Matter of fact, the Chinese church has been praying for us for a long time. Because we've been praying for us, they're persecuted. They're thriving in their persecution. And much in America, we're dating homosexual bishops. We got churches that don't believe in hell anymore. They don't preach the gospel anymore. They compromise and water down the word of God. God's only concerned about your happiness. No, that's not true. Not true. Not true. A false message that's real popular with people. It tickles people's ears. I told somebody yesterday, some of the things I'm telling you now and more. I said, I'm not going to tickle your ears. I want to be a fruit of God, and I'm going to preach his word. I'm not going to compromise it. I'm not going to adulterate it. I'm not going to water it down. You need the truth of God's word. So many places it is. So many places it is. Preaching whatever's popular. He says, then it will hand you over to suffer affliction and tribulation, persecution, and put you to death. And you'll be hated of all nations for my name's sake. That was not only from the Roman Christians back in the days, under 10 Roman emperors, fed the lions, put on torches, covered with tar, but became, put on sticks, but covered with tar, and became torches for Nero. Sure. That's your brothers and sisters, little children that died for the faith in Christ. Yes. It's happening now. Yes. Happening now. It's not really happening here in America, but it's coming. It's coming. It's coming. There's two more quick things I want to show you. This is a picture of men about to be beheaded. They're probably dead right now without their heads because they would not renounce their faith. This is real deal. Happening right now. Now this is what Paul said to the disciples. When they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned unto Lystra and to Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, that we must through much tribulation or persecution enter the kingdom of God. They're not even with us now. They've been executed. Their heads were cut off. Not with a sword, but a knife. I've seen one of them. It was horrible, horrible. Absolutely horrible. And you know what happens? And again, I'm really going to close. I can't get to the other part. I just got to show you this real quick. Why would many be offended? This is not supposed to happen. God, why would you let this happen to me? I'm not serving you. You let this happen to me. You let my family be killed. You let all this happen to me. I'm not going to serve you. Listen, it says many will be offended, enticed to sin, apostasy, and shall betray one another. They're going to be offended. I'm not supposed to be here. My pastor said the rapture was going to happen, and I wasn't going to be here. What am I like? Am I going through all this? It's going to happen. And you've got to be mentally prepared and in prayer. Be ready. Listen, God's going to give us great grace and great anointing in the midst of this. I believe he'll multiply food like he did in Jesus' day. He multiplied the fishes and loaves. We'll have the glory, but it's going to be increased because of us coming as never before. More than they had in the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, let's get back to the book of Acts. Pastor Joe, James was beheaded. Peter was thrown in jail when the church prayed. And Paul persecuted the church, throwing men and women into jail and prisons. That's how it began. Guess how it's going to end? Lot's coming. It's happening now. Happening now. And many, many will be offended because they're not mentally ready. I want to get you ready. So you can understand. Some little things are so petty that we hold against people right now. Well, I can't forgive her. She talked about me. All that's going out the window. All that's going out the window. That's minor stuff. Some of us major on the minors, and you get all offended, can't hear from God. They sat in your seat and whatever, these minor little bitty things. How are you going to run with the horses? You can't run with the footmen. Then you fall away. You go quit. No. The road to heaven is now his last, literally last one. I'll show you this. False prophets, ministers who teach universalism. Everybody goes to heaven. Popular movie, The Shack. They didn't really put it in the movie, but universalism, everybody gets redeemed. No, that's not true. People go to hell. People die and go to hell. More than go to hell, and I wish it was true. They all went to heaven, but they don't. It's not true. Hell is enlarges itself. Go read Isaiah. It enlarges itself to make room for people at their coming. Well, they teach you many ways to God. There's not many ways to God. There's one way to God. One name. It's not Muhammad. He's a false prophet. Preachers won't say that. They say Christmas is the same God. No, it's not the same God. Jesus is God. Our God is God. Only his blood can redeem you. There's no other way to God. Amen. Try to get to my house going any way you want. You'll never get there. You'll never get there. Yeah. There's one way to God, and it's Jesus Christ. He's the door. No man will get to the Father but by him. There's no redemption any other. Preachers talking about Chris Long. Oh, it's all the same. Then when a preacher speaks of it, some of them get blamed on the TV, because at the TV people don't want them to say, oh, it's not popular. They twist what the Bible says to cater to their own lusts. Oh yeah.
That's right.
Water down God's word and his grace. Yes, God will forgive you, but there's repercussions for our sin. And we turn the grace of God to lasciviousness. People living together, living in homosexuality, living in sin, and calling themselves Christian and anointed one. How deceived is that? If you live a homosexual lifestyle, you will die and go to hell if you don't repent. If you're living with somebody in fornication, you will die and go to hell if you don't repent. If you lie, if you steal, if you cheat, if you're impure, if you're living, if you're a pornographer, you will go to hell if you don't repent. From the pulpit to the pew. That's the word of God. One man had sons and one was running the whole world. And Jesus appeared to him and said, if I came today, you would not come. He said, you've been lusting after the women in church. You've been undressing them with your mind. They said, we don't have somebody. Well, no, no, no. God said it was real because I love my people, not because of you. That's true. We've got to be pure and holy in thought, word, and deed. So he said, please man and approve of homosexual marriage. No. As a man and woman, there's 200 genders now, they say. 200! There's only two, man and woman! The world's so confused! Television's on television! One man said, he said, God, when is the end going to come? And he said, when you see wickedness openly on the streets, wickedness openly seen on TV, it's way out of the closet. They're proud. Movie actors are proud they're homosexual. They're proud they're gay. They're proud of it with what? Gay pride. Proud of their sin. Defying God. Got Christians that went back into the closet to hide. Yeah, we should pray in the closet and come out with boldness and power that our God is God. Many are repenting to come into Christ, but they get so emboldened in their sin. In our government, in places of authority, and they don't love you. They say, oh, we're intolerant. But they're the ones that are intolerant. They're the ones that are shooting people and doing things. My goodness. So time we live right now, some of us need to wake up. Test the days of Lot. Sunny day outside, right? Hurricane Katrina hit. I never forget the day. Beautiful sunny day. Gorgeous day. Spent all my time fixing stuff around the house. I mean, it was a day. Oh, it was cool. It was nice. It was a beautiful day. The next day, everything changed. When I came back, it looked like Mars. And when these things happen, suddenly it's going to happen. Suddenly a change is going to happen. It's going to happen that way. The day they go into the ark, that day, that's when it all came. Yeah. Suddenly, you better be ready for the suddenly. I'm like a drill sergeant right now trying to get the troops ready in the name of Jesus. I'm trying to get you guys to battle. I'm trying to get you full of the Holy Ghost. I'm trying to get you full of the Word of God. Some of y'all want to get in your face like you did me. What's the matter with your recruits? You're not talking right, you're not walking right, you're not acting right. Get right, get right, get right, get right, get right. Saints. I pray for courage and strength in the name of Jesus to come upon each and every one of them. Father, I pray the blessing of God. Oh, Father, that this is the blessing I pray, Father. There's one thing that they need more than anything else, Father, and it's you. You. So, God, I ask you that you pour out your grace upon this house, that when they walk in the door, they'll hear from God. They'll have revelation, that they'll go deeper into their relationship with you. This is a blessing I ask for this church and for everyone here, that they know you from the greatest to the least in intimacy, that they know your voice, God, and that they'll hunger and thirst after righteousness. Oh, Father, I ask this for your people. I ask this blessing on every house, Lord God, on all of your people. In the name of Jesus.